to it, Nikita Koloff, the Russian nightmare here. And when I watch sports, I watch Fox. Got the game. What are you watching?
Welcome back. A lot of testosterone in the room, and that's a good thing. Ladies and gentlemen, you've seen them on TV. Now they're gracing us here in the Fox Den. Batista, Ric Flair, the Nature Boy. Woo! Woo! Gentlemen, welcome. Thank you very much for coming here.
Thank you, sir.
How's everything going?
Good.
Yeah. Now, you guys have been busy teaming up together and also doing some individual things. But
actually,
I know
our first tag match tonight in 5 years.
What's it like for you to finally get to hook up again with this guy? I know you guys are friends from way back, and you know, we can see the look on your face.
We're friends, but you know, it's one of those things where, you know, Rick's, he's such a legend, and every once in a while, I'll still catch myself. You know, thinking, you know, sitting here with Ric Flair, you know, it's like, it doesn't seem real. It's very surreal. It's like a dream, you know.
Tonight to be reunited with Dave, you know, every time I think I'm this much closer to retiring, I stay another year. And I think this will be the last year. And to spend the last year with Dave, we became really close friends. He was at my wedding last year, and Donna Grand came in. We've had a real special relationship. He's one of the good guys in our business. Flagship of SmackDown.
You know, talking about the business, you have seen so many changes through the years. You've been wrestling the 70s, 80s, 90s, now this decade. What's the biggest change that you've seen?
The biggest change is marketing. I mean, truly, I think the level of the athletes, of course, has increased. The abilities increased. The size of the athletes increased. But the marketing is what's made the difference. I mean, we've always had a lot of really talented guys, but nobody, you know, knew how to market like Vince McMahon, and nobody was able to take our business to the next level. And now, I mean, not just in my opinion, but I think in the expectation of anybody that's out there watching that wants to learn how to market, our company is ahead of the NBA, NFL, Major League Baseball. I mean, people are trying to catch us in terms of how to market and put people's faces on TV.
Do you sometimes pinch yourself? I mean, I was reading over your bio a little bit, and you've come a long way not a short time, but not a huge amount of time.
Actually, I mean, in wrestling terms, it's very short. It happened, you know, it was a very rapid rise to the top, and it was really because I was fortunate enough to be, you know, under the wing of Rick. And Rick just, you know, took me down the highways and schooled me. You know, it's not one of those things where, I knew all the moves. Yeah, I knew. I trained for wrestling for 2 years, and I knew how to, you know, do all the moves. But he kind of, you know, kind of schooled me on, you know, the art form of wrestling. You know, how to entertain a crowd, how to draw a crowd in. You know, how to just make it, you know, entertainment, and just, you know, make it an art. And also how to, you know, learn with living on the road, which for me was not easy at first.
Talk about living on the road. How hard? What is it that people might not know about it?
What?
Lonely nights.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say.
A lot of driving, a lot of flying. And since 9/11, a lot of airports you can't stand to walk through. Right. It's the whole demographic of traveling and industry has changed since 9/11, as it has for anyone that travels a lot. But I mean, the truth is, in our show, it's glamorous. We've got everything going in the world. But we're not out of the building at 12 o'clock at night on Monday or Tuesday night. So you tell me where you're going. Nothing happens anywhere except Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. So it's not what it used to be. Like in the 80s, you know, we were there, plugged the hotel, big party afterwards. I mean, once in a while.
Sometimes it is.
Yeah. It's not that bad, but I mean, it's just different. And traveling is very hard. It is. We travel 250, 300 days a year. I don't. He does. You know, Dave works. He's a champion, flagship for our company. And Dave works in a merciful schedule.
And also, yeah, really just being away from home, being away from our families. Rick and I both have families, and that's the hardest part, I think, is being away from your kids and, you know, sacrifice a lot as far as that goes.
I guess that's hard because you're at the top. You want to keep running and gunning as long as you can. You know, do whatever you can, make as much money as you can. But then again, like you said, the human component of missing your kids, missing your family, I mean, it's got to be tough. How do you balance that?
I don't know if you can balance, you know, missing your kids. You know, it's one of those things. It's a sacrifice more than a balance. You know, and so one of those things where, you know, in our families, they understand. They, you know, they've grown up with it. You know, our kids have grown up with it, and they know this. You know, that's what Dad does for a living. You know, as much as you can, you bring them on the road with you, and every once in a while, you're lucky enough to be in your hometown.
What's tougher, being out in a match, a very physical match, a lot of give and go, that, or having to do the promos, especially when you're doing the promos out in the middle of the ring where you really can't screw up, and if you do screw up, you got to cover yourself real quick so it doesn't look like you screw up. What's tougher?
I don't know. I feel good about them both. You know, I've had confidence issues. I'm not a secret. That's not a secret to anybody. But when I'm on, I'm on. I like them both. I hope they let me talk all night tonight.
For me, I'm actually, that's still a phobia of mine. I was a shy kid, and public speaking was hard for me, and still is hard.
You can go on YouTube and look at you in the 70s and the 80s through the WCW or through the NWA area, and then in the 90s with WCW and going into, is it weird looking back at four generations of yourself?
It is kind of, but you know, it's funny, I have never been like an historian of myself or wrestling. I mean, I watch wrestling. I watch, which is sad to say, this is not anything about the product, but I watched SmackDown Friday night for the first time in a year because Dave and I were on it for the first time. I mean, last week, you know.
Right.
So, when I'm home, I like watching, you know, college football, college basketball, stuff like that.
Who's your team, by the way?
Well, now it's the Gamecocks in football. You know, and of course, I'm still with Billy Donovan and the Gators. Thank God Billy went back, you know. But I'm a big Steve Spurrier fan, you know that.
Sure, yeah. From way back. And who's your favorite college?
Actually, you know, I don't follow sports a whole lot. You know, I'm usually, I wrestle so much. I follow a little bit of basketball when I can. A little bit, you know, of course, I'm a Yankees fan. I get a lot of grief over that.
I'm a great fan of the Yankees, too.
Wouldn't love A-Rod.
And, you know, I heard that not only do you like the Yankees, but you collect lunch boxes?
Yeah, I do collect lunch boxes.
What's
up with
that?
I get a lot of grief over that, too. It's just, you know, I started collection. I was married, and I bought my wife a lunchbox. I went in, she got her first office job ever, and I wanted to get her something cool. So I got her this old vintage lunchbox. And, you know, when I got it, I didn't want to give it up. It was just so cool. It brought back a lot of memories.
What kind of lunchbox was it? Like a Maxwell Smart lunchbox?
It was an ET lunchbox.
Oh, okay.
it was brand new. Still had the tags on from 1982.
Don't be talking about ET out here with me. Are you kidding me?
Oh, that's fine. How many lunchboxes do you think you have right now?
Maybe 100 or so.
What's your favorite?
I have a 1967 Green Hornet lunchbox. Oh. It's my favorite.
Yeah. Very nice. Yeah. Very nice.
He's also got 100 cars. I'm going to keep his image up here. He's got 100 cars, 100 custom-made suits,
cars as well.
Biggest house in Tampa. He's got a lot more going on besides lunchboxes.
So basically,
lunchboxes.
We'll see him cruising down the Gulf Coast, you know, in a big car with lunchboxes all over the back.
Yeah.
Ric Flair, the fabulous Batista. You see him all the time on WWE. And, gentlemen, it's been a pleasure.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right.
Boom!